How safe is medical cannabis? With all things drug-related, a level-headed and objective risk-benefit analysis is eminently desirable. Fasten your seatbelts for this rapid-fire presentation. Linda Klumpers, Cannify.
Thank you. Hello, everyone. Well, I think I'm the only one with a belt because otherwise my microphone wouldn't clip on. So I changed the title of this presentation. I am Linda Klumpers. I am a clinical pharmacologist. So what I do is actually a bit comparable to what Professor Campolongo does, but I do it with humans. I will just not do too invasive measurements. I won't decapitate them after the trial, which means chopping their heads off. But I think it's really nice that she gave this presentation because, yeah, I will touch on some of the topics. But I only have, I don't know how much time because it's not displayed. So let's start. My title is different. The title in your program says, how safe is cannabis? And if someone would ask me that question, I would ask them, okay, what cannabis are you talking about? And who are we giving this to? And the reason why I'm trying to explain to you, and I would like to start with the origins of the science of pharmacology. That's this plant. Does anyone know here which plant this is? No one has a garden? This is foxglove. And foxglove is a very special plant because pharmacology science started with this. If you take this plant, and almost any aspect of this plant, any part is poisonous, you will get symptoms, you will not feel well, and it can also disturb your heart. And if you give this plant, this was discovered around 200 years ago, if you give this to a person with atrial fibrillation, which is a heart disorder, you actually treat them. So depending on who you give this to, it will either, well, damage you or it will treat you. And now I'd like to jump from the foxglove to cannabis and start with what does cannabis actually do in humans? Because you hear often about all the benefits, and we will go briefly through a few. It will make life more livable for people with pain. It does not really decrease pain by a whole lot. But this is already very important. And it will also reduce the perception of spasticity in patients with multiple sclerosis. Chemotherapy-induced nausea and vomiting relief, a very well-known one. In the 1980s, medication came on the market for this indication. And last year, in February, the FDA approved a CBD compound, Epidiolex, for a reduction of epileptic seizures. And then, what Professor Campolongo explained, it decreases anxiety. Certain aspects of anxiety. And not by a whole lot, but it does something on that anxiety. And what is really interesting is that if you look at the side effect profile, the most side effects that are known to all of you are typically pretty mild. It can also increase anxiety. That's a pretty complex pharmacological mechanism, how that works, the decrease and the increase of anxiety by the same plant. It also will skew your time perception, increase your heart rate, and there are dozens of other symptoms, side effects that you can get from cannabis. Typically, they're very mild. However, there are also very severe side effects with cannabis. So, for example, anxiety might not be so pleasant, but you can also suffer from a panic attack. You can lose the connection with reality and become psychotic. And something else that can happen is that you can suffer from a heart attack. There's a higher chance if you are sensitive to this. Normal use is not a problem. But people can actually get addicted to it, dependent on it, cannabis use disorder. I'm not sure how much time I have, but let me tell this little anecdote. When I was having a meal yesterday with one of the participants, and she shared with me that if she does not use cannabis, oh, there's my time. Right? If she does not use cannabis, she will suffer from very vivid nightmares. It's really unpleasant, and she needs to use cannabis to suppress these nightmares. And I just listened, and I did not really talk with her about this, but this probably is a cannabis use disorder problem, and it's not treating a symptom that she already had, because cannabis suppresses your REM sleep. So that is the phase in sleep that you get all your dreams. So if you stop using cannabis when you're used to it, all these dreams, boom, will come out at once. And it's not necessarily pleasant dreams. Most people suffer from nightmares. So I think that that is what was actually happening with her. Good. So these are the side effects. You might wonder, okay, so I see these very severe side effects. When do they happen, and to who do they happen? So let's go over what causes these effects. Well, firstly, the sensitivity for developing these disorders. There was this whole discussion with some New York Times writer who said, oh, cannabis can make you more violent and can cause schizophrenia and things like that. It's really a trigger. It's not a cause, but it can trigger particular diseases that we or symptoms that we just went over in people who are sensitive to these symptoms. On the other hand, what we already saw with the foxglove, if you have a particular pathology, the cannabis might also work differently in your body compared to when you are a healthy person. And we will go over this in the next slide. Then genetics. This also covers this whole sensitivity part, because if you have family, first degree family with, for example, schizophrenia, you have a higher chance of developing psychotic disorders when you use cannabis. But genetics covers much more. It also tells something about how you break down cannabis, and so what the dose effect actually is. And that is the other important part, of course, of what the symptoms will look like. If you take 1 milligram versus 101 milligram, that will, of course, give a huge difference in effect. But that is when you know what the dose is. And a problem with many cannabis products is that you don't always know. You don't always know whether what you get in your product is actually what is on the label, and vice versa, especially with CBD products. Many studies have been published about that. But also, if you take your dose in combination with particular foods or medication, you can get an interaction between the two. So then the dose that you take is not necessarily the dose that you feel, let's say. Contaminants, pesticides, heavy metals, molds. But there's another thing going on that I really wanted to touch upon, and that is namely other ingredients than cannabis that a lot of the producers put in their products, and that they think is safe, but nobody actually knows. Because if you take a compound, it's very safe to put on your apple and to swallow, like particular pesticides or whatever it is, a terpene, and you heat it up and you inhale it, that works very different in your body from just swallowing it. So we are doing a lot of things with products and putting ingredients in, and we don't really know how they work. It's very important to realize in the first place that you don't know what you're doing. And that realization will help us with better understanding things that are happening, like this vaping crisis. I might get political here, but everyone talks about this vaping crisis because quite some people died. But every weekend, how many people die because of alcohol? In any case, what we are seeing here is the lungs of a 17-year-old male. He was hospitalized for a lung disorder that suddenly came up. Median time for this developing is 6 days. You see all these opaque patches that are all, unhealthy tissue. This boy had to be put on mechanic ventilation to survive, and he did survive, but many others don't survive. And we're not looking here at a disease that develops over 20 or 30 years, like cancer with tobacco. These people, the median age of people getting sick is around 19 years old, and we don't know what causes it. Okay, I'll just go on because I don't want to have this background music for too long. I want to go into how pathology can influence these side effects. And now we quickly look to the pathology. This is the one before last slide. What we're looking at here is two brain scans. So you have to imagine that you slice your head like this and you look on top of it. With at the top of the page, this is the forehead and this is the back of your head. This bar here in the blue color depicts a low number of particular binding places where THC binds on. These are called cannabinoid type 1 receptors or CB1 receptors, and red is high. So this person here with post-traumatic stress disorder, so that's on your left side, has a high density of CB1 receptors, and this healthy control, a low density. What you see is that the endocannabinoid system is deregulated. I don't want to go into details whether this is a direct or an indirect effect, but what I want to tell you is that if you dose this person with compounds that bind to this receptor, if you treat this person with THC versus this person, you might imagine the very different effects will take place. So physiology, different physiology requires a different treatment. So the only point I wanted to make is it's really dependent what you're giving, who you're giving it to, and you need to combine all these different elements to make a really well risk-benefit analysis. If you go to work with a headache and I say, oh, here, you got a pill, you might just vomit 5 times in the coming 5 hours, but you know, you'll get rid of your headache. You might not want to do it. If you're going to lose your leg and you might vomit 5 times, you might want to take it. So everything's about risk benefits. Thank you very much for having me here. I want to acknowledge some other people too.